Let's continue our journey in the book of Luke, chapter 6. Turn your Bibles towards there, Luke chapter 6, verses 20 through 26. Gospel of Luke, chapter 6, verses 20 through 26. Luke chapter 6, verse 20 through 26. Let's read together. Looking at his disciples, he said, "Blessed are you who are poor, for yours is the kingdom of God. Blessed are you who hunger now, for you will be satisfied. Blessed are you who weep now, for you will laugh. Blessed are you who men hate you when they exclude you and insult you and reject your name as evil because of the Son of Man. Rejoice in that day and leap for joy, because great is your reward in heaven. For that is how their fathers treated the prophets. But woe to you who are rich, for you have already received your comfort. Woe to you who are well fed now, for you will go hungry. Woe to you who laugh now, for you will mourn and weep. Woe to you when all men speak well of you, for that is how their fathers treated the false prophets." Now we go through the Gospel of Luke, and I hope that we remember week after week what we are learning from the scripture. And the objective to understand, especially from the Gospels, is to understand the teachings of Jesus. And the ultimate purpose of Christian life that we believe is to become like Christ. That is the ultimate purpose of our life. So that is, we look into God's word, and especially that the teachings that Jesus has taught to his disciples, to us, in that manner, how we can behave as the citizens of God's kingdom. That is what the text or the scripture that tells us this morning. Last week we have seen that Jesus called 12 of the disciples and sent them as apostles. There are a lot of disciples that follow Jesus, and out of them, Jesus called 12 of them. And now we see, and Luke is introducing the second sermon, and in Luke, in chapter 4, that we have seen the first sermon that Jesus was preaching in the synagogue after reading the text, the scripture from Isaiah, and he talked to the people from that, and primarily that was to everyone, to the crowd who was there in the synagogue in that place in his vicinity. But here we see that this is to the disciples. Verse 20, it says, looking at his disciples. And chapter 6, verse 17, that we read, a large crowd of his disciples was there, and a great number of people. A crowd and a disciples. Two group of people that we see over there. And Jesus is particularly talking little more deeper things that to his disciples now. The crowd might have heard what Jesus was talking, but the primary audience is the disciples. So the things that we are going to learn or read today is for the disciples. And I believe that every one of us, those who are here as followers of Christ, we are the disciples. When we have an intimate relationship with the Christ, then only these things we talk about become meaningful. When we talk about God can comfort you, heal you, deliver you, provide for you, all those things, that can be applicable to everyone else actually. Everyone will be comforted by that. Everybody will be happy about to hear those kinds of things. But things like this, little more difficult to preach, because it is difficult to live also. So bear with me as we are going to go through these things this morning. And what is here? Jesus is explaining this sermon. You know, from here to all the way the end of this chapter, in all the way the chapter end, the four things that Jesus is talking. Four principles for a blessed life. Four principles for a blessed life. So Jesus is trying to tell them that, or tell us in that, you know, being blessed is not only that we get things. Because this was one of their questions. Because Luke says that they left everything and followed Jesus. They left everything and followed Jesus. And they have a concern in their heart. They ask this question, we left everything and follow you, what we will get? Jesus is telling to us and to this group of people that, you know, being blessed is not only what we get. Being blessed is not even what we do. Being blessed is what we become or being. So that is what it says. You know, we become. Not only just receiving something
or we are doing something, but being is the blessedness. That is what Jesus is focusing over here. So four things that we see in chapter 6 verse 20 to all the way to 49. The four things. Number one is that the faith in God. Faith in God. Number two, love towards others. And three, honesty with ourselves. And four, obedience towards God. Faith in God, love towards others, honesty with ourselves, and obedience towards God. Or another way that we can see that Jesus is talking about the attitudes. The attitude towards the circumstances, the attitude towards people, attitude towards ourselves, and attitude towards God. Attitude towards circumstances, attitude towards people, attitude towards ourselves, and also even to God. How we react and respond to these things. And someone else summarized this in such a way, it says that, you know, being honest in ourselves, being happy in ourselves, the first part, being honest before God, or in harmony with other people, be holy before God. Being happy in ourselves, that may be one thing that everybody want to be happy in their lives. So how that can happen? How do we respond and react to circumstance? That is a thing we are going to see rest of the chapter of Luke. And we see the same sermon in one way in Matthew chapter 5 through 7 also. People try to argue, to try to understand, there are two different sermons. You know, one is called the Sermon on the Mount. Here it is called the Sermon on the Plain. And some others are believe that this is, you know, Luke is giving more editorial work over here. And he is trying to bring only four of the Beatitudes that Jesus mentioned. The sermon is the same. And as a preacher, as a teacher, I believe that Jesus might have repeated many times, right? That is a best way to teach something, right? We repeat it again and again. As an effective teacher, Jesus might have repeated the sermons or the principles he are trying to teach again and again to these people. So it can be both, or it can be two different things. So let us look into that, what it says. What Jesus finally or exclusively tell these people, actually, the radical rules that Jesus is trying to bring before the people. The radical rules to live a life as a part of the kingdom of God. The radical rules. What is that? And it's interesting, actually, when we talk about the rules, you know, we resist and resent rules. And that is what it is. You know, when there is a rule, some people believe that why there is rules? Rules are there to break, right? That is what there is rules are. So the rules are, sometimes we need it. But unfortunately, many a time we reject it also. What is a reaction to rule? Again, this is not rules, actually. This is the principles Jesus brings. But we are trying to say that, actually, how do we react and respond to rules? The problem with the rules are, rules makes us unhappy because, you know, we know that we are not able to make it, so that makes us miserable, guilty, right? When there is a rule, when we break it, you know, that makes us miserable and difficult, so they think that, you know, rules are miserable and it makes us unhappy. And when there is rules, we try to make excuse not to abide by it, right? And we try to find loopholes there. You know, this is again April, right? Tax month. So what we do, we try to find loopholes how to avoid things. You know, people ask questions always. You know, sometimes we try to see that. There is a man who went to a doctor. The doctor said, you watch your drinking. Now he went, ever since, he only drink from the bars, there is a mirror. You know, so he watches his drinking. So we try to find loopholes in doing things. You know, when it comes to the demands that Jesus even make also, we try to find loopholes into that also. So the other problem with the Pharisees, the other audience that Jesus was dealing with, the problem with the people are, you know, they try to use these rules as a tool to exclude other people. So they, you know, I think this, we do also this, right? You know, they try to use this as a tool to exclude other people. That means, you know, these are the 1, 2, 3 I do, and you don't do that because you don't come to my circle at all. That was what the Pharisees were doing, actually. They have laws and bylaws and other laws they added to all these things. And they are meticulous and particular that they are doing all these things. And when they are doing it, they are examining other people based upon what they do and what they don't do also. Other people don't do also. So you are not part of this circle. Why? Because you don't do 1, 2, 3. That is the way people try to do also. But Jesus brings this radical principle to these people. This is very demanding in that sense. This may not make us happy in one way, but this will make us surely bless us. So listen to this, what Jesus is trying to teach us over here. This is called again the Beatitudes. The Beatitudes, there are 9 statements we see in Matthew's gospel. Here Luke brings only 4 of them. And again, the Beatitude is not a requirement to enter into the kingdom of God. It is not a requirement to enter into the kingdom of God. But this is the manifesto of the citizen of the kingdom of God. This is not as a requirement, it's a prerequisite, you know, to enter into the kingdom. How do you enter into the kingdom? It is believe. That is as it is, not to behave. But when you become the part of the kingdom of God, you behave as a citizen. That is important. So these Beatitudes are that. This is the manifesto of the kingdom of God. This is the principles that the disciples of Jesus should abide and they should live on this earth as the citizens of God's kingdom on this place. This is the quality and character, and this is the lifestyle of the disciples. That is what Jesus is bringing before the people. Blessed, blessed, blessed. That is Jesus repeating that thing. That word simply means literally is blissful or be happy. Or you take a thought-to-thought translation, it can say to be enlarged. You know, to be being in a state of blissfulness. That is what Jesus is trying to say, that how you can be a blessed. This is where the happiness comes from. Now, this is not only an Old New Testament concept either. This is not only something that Jesus is bringing new. In the Old Testament also that we see the blessedness of the people. Now, remember that the Psalm 1 started, blessed is the man who does not walk and sit and stay. So the Old Testament also bringing or pronouncing the blessedness of the people. The conditions in the Old Testament for the blessedness that we read is that, number one, they who trust God, the people, those who trust God, they are the blessed one. The people, those who hope and wait for God, they are the blessed one. The people, those who fear God, they are the blessed one. People, those who love God, they are the blessed one. We can see in a scripture after scripture in the Old Testament also that we see those who trust God, those who fear God, those who wait upon God, those who love God, they are the people, those who are blessed in the Old Testament. So here Jesus brings, you know, something very unique. 2 sets of principles. One is talking about being blessed. The other one is talking about woe, or being rich and poor, being content and need. You know, both are bringing as a contrast that Luke brings over here. In Matthew's gospel, again, there is only the Beatitudes, only the positive side only that we see. Blessed, blessed, blessed. But here, 4 of the blessedness, then we see 4 woes also that Luke bring over here. There Jesus bring a contrast over here. The contrast is this, the earthly estimation of what happened over here. And there is a day is going to come in a heavenly realm, a spiritual realm of life also. This contrast bring over here. So the both places, you know, Luke says that be poor, be hungry, those who mourn and weep, those who are hated and persecuted by this world. What happened to these people? So again, when you look at that, there is a simple principle. When you read this, you can see one is life now and life later. And life with God, life without God. That contrast that we see in the 4 of this principle or the 8 verses that we look into over here. Hope that makes sense to you as we look into them one by one. Let us look over here. You know, what would be the attitude toward our circumstances? Or how do we find happiness in our lives? Luke chapter 6 verse 20 through 26. Again, Luke is very plain. Luke is very concerned about the poor people. And remember that when even Jesus was preaching in the first sermon, he said that the Spirit of the Lord is on me, and God has appointed me to preach the good news to the poor, to the needy, to those who are bound in chains. So that was a concern, I think, that we can see that Luke has over here. So when Matthew writes, he says those who are hunger after righteousness, he make it more spiritualized, the principles over here. Luke simply say that those who hunger. So we see the contrast over here. So let us look at this question, these principles, and how that is applicable to us today. What would be our attitude towards circumstances, or how do we find happiness in ourselves? Number one, that is, a blessed are the poor. Blessed are the poor. Poor yet blessed. That is a contrast, or there is an oxymoron over there itself. So Jesus is, you know, listen to this actually. This is important to understand. There is again two extremes that we see in Christendom. There is two different principles, or two different gospels, we can say, that we see in church also. One is called the prosperity gospel. The other one is called the poverty gospel. Jesus is not condoning that being poor is something blessed, or he is not condemning being prosperous is something wrong either. He didn't say any of those things. Remember that. This is very simple to understand. Jesus is saying that, oh, those who poor people are nice people, good people, blessed people, happy people. He didn't say that. Oh, all the rich people, prosperous people, they are bad and they are wrong. He didn't say that either. That's not what it says. What it says over here then, what that means. He's not saying that poverty is a good thing. No, poverty is not a good thing at all. Those who are poor, it is difficult. It is challenging. It is hard. You know, it is not an easy life at all. Don't think that there's something, you know, good in that. No, there is nothing good in itself. Jesus didn't say any of those things at all. It's not poverty nor prosperity. But being in the kingdom is the blessedness. It is not being poor or not being rich. It's being in the kingdom is the blessedness. That is what Jesus is trying to say. We can be rich without God. And that you all understand that, right? We can be rich without God also. There are the richest people in the world. Now, I don't think that, you know, many of them have any relationship with the God at all. Their God is their money. Their God is their effort. And if you work hard, if you live by the principles, you do things, you can be rich also. You don't need God for that at all. And that is why many of the people don't have God in their lives, because they think that it is my muscle, it is my money, and it is my mind. That's what people think also. So what Jesus is trying to say over here, the principles left, the disciples left everything to follow Jesus. Looking at them and say that, you know, blessed those who are poor. And again, Matthew says that blessed those who are poor in spirit. Here Luke simply stopped there. Blessed those who are poor. Blessed those who are poor. And, you know, but both ways we can see that. You know, blessed or favored those who are poor. You know, there are spiritual poverty and there is material poverty. Metaphorically and also, you know, directly, this word we can say. If we look in the Old Testament, that we see the spiritual examples, the term poor is used. You know, especially in the Psalms, that we see that again and again. Psalms 40 verse 17. Psalm 40 verse 17. Psalm 86 verse 1. Psalm 109 verse 22. Now, all these places, we know that those Psalms are David's Psalm. Who was David? David was the king, right? And he was the king. He was a powerful man. He was a rich man also in that sense. So all these places, what David says, I am poor and needy. You know, the none of those doesn't mean that David was a poor man. What is that? Shows that there. He talk about his spiritual poverty or his humility before God. That is what he brings over here. Clearly, none of these places, you know, David was not poor. Rather, he says that, you know, the spiritual need that he has. You know, yes, I have all these things, but none of those things cannot help me. I am needy. I have need more than these things. That is what he's trying to say. So poverty or poor, that the term can be used as a spiritual term. It as Matthew says, you know, those who are poor in spirit, those who are humble, those who are willing to accept their spiritual bankruptcy into their life and seeking for God's help in their places. It can be material also. And in the Luke's context that we see, Luke was very concerned about the poor people. And we can see that his writing as we go further, you know, again and again. And he talked about the people, those who trust in the wealth and of their own efforts or their prosperity and success. And he tried to put light upon them and say, that is not the way you should live. And the teachings of Jesus, he bring over there in the places, the rich fool, remember that story? And about the rich man Lazarus in chapter 16, all these places, he tried to bring something unique and say that, you know, this life, you can have everything here, but that is not the end of it. There is something more than that. So here, we understand that this beatitude fits especially well with the believing poor. And David was a man who was humbled before God. But here, Luke brings over here, or Jesus tells them, blessed are the poor. What is the reason? He didn't say that being poor is blessed. But rather, blessed are the poor. What is the reason? He says, blessed are the poor, who you are poor, for yours is the kingdom of God. The reason for being blessed is not, again, not richness or poverty, rather being in the kingdom of God. Remember that. We may not have much. These disciples didn't have anything else. Jesus didn't have much. I mean, Paul talked about Jesus. He said that he emptied himself and he became poor so that you may become rich. So that's what Jesus said, the one who created everything. He lived in this world as a needy person. And the disciples also lived like that. The disciples also lived like that. Again, remember that. God will bless us, as we see further over here. God will bless us with all our needs. Don't forget that. But what it says over here, how we find contentment, how do you find happiness in life? The other woe, it says that those who are rich, they think that that's all they needed. And Jesus said, woe unto these people. But how you and I respond to circumstances in life, being blessed even though there is lack, there is need, how do we do that? Jesus says that blessed those who are poor, because theirs is the kingdom of God. Theirs is the kingdom of God. Look at this actually. Just ask this question. If God is our portion, are you rich or poor then? Look at the Old Testament. It says that in Genesis chapter 15, verse 1. There we read that God talked to Abraham. One of the famous verses that all of us know that very well. In Genesis chapter 15, verse 1. It says that, do not be afraid, Abraham. God appeared to him and said, do not be. After this, the word of the Lord came to Abraham in a vision. Do not be afraid, Abraham. I am your shield. You are very great reward. I am your shield. After this, after what? Abraham was offered by the king of Sodom some money, some reward. And you know, he was there and he rejected that. And he was trying to rescue his nephew Lot. And he went through all these challenges. He was afraid of the enemy may come after them. And he didn't receive the reward that the other king tried to offer him. And he was waiting for the promises, the fulfillment of the promise in his life. So a lot of things are going on in his life. God appeared to him and said, do not be afraid, Abraham. I am your great reward. I am your portion. This morning, we may have so many needs. Yes, we have many needs. There are emotional, physical, financial, relational, even spiritual. There are so many needs out there in our lives. But we all are blessed, not because we have many things that other people don't have, rather because God is our great reward. God is our portion. When we understand and realize that, our life will be a blessed state. You know, this morning again, I want to say this. You know, those who seek, those who are asked, those who are looking for God's guidance and grace and provisions in your life, God is the great reward. And look, in Romans, Paul asked that question, if God is for us, who can be against us? You know, this was the delight of the psalmist again and again. They say in Psalm 16, verse 5, we read that, Lord, you alone are my portion and my cup. You make my lot secure. You alone are my portion and my cup. You make my lot secure. Psalm 73, verse 25, Asaph writes that he was puzzled by the prosperity of the wicked and he was living in his difficulties and challenges. He was faithful and does everything and done everything to the Lord. Finally, he says that it is waste of doing all these things and serving God. And he went back finally to the temple, to the presence of God. And he says that, look at, and the perspective was changed. There he declared like this, whom I have in heaven other than you. On earth I will not desire anyone else other than you, O God. So when we realize this, it is not the poverty, it is not about prosperity, rather being in the kingdom. So that blessed, thank God, that I believe that each of us are in that blessed state now. Amen. We all are in this blessed state because God is with us and we belong to God. So how does this statement, his words are a statement and to his followers, and they don't have much again, but look at them, what Jesus tells them, blessed who you are. You left everything and follow me, but remember that you are a blessed state. And the second thing that Jesus says over here is that blessed those who are hunger now, for you will be satisfied. Again, unlike Matthew, Luke simply stopped over there and not thirst after righteousness. He simply said those who are hungry. Following Jesus by his disciples involved a lot of struggles and difficulties into their lives also. They didn't have much into their lives. But Jesus made this promise over here. This hunger will not be last forever. This hunger will not last forever. This is the promise that we see. What happened? When we have a need in life, where do we go? We go before God. Why? Because God has promised that our basic needs will be met by God. That's a promise that God has made. Look at the scripture, what it says in Psalms 107, verse 8 and 9. Psalms 107, verse 8 and 9. And you talk about praising God and what God has done in the past. The psalmist says that let them give thanks to the Lord for his unfailing love and his wonderful deeds for mankind. For he satisfies the thirsty and fills the hungry with the good things. And there is one more beautiful expression of God's provision that we see in the Psalms 147, verse 9. Psalm 147, verse 9. Look at this verse. He provides food for the cattle and for the young ravens when they call. You know, I like the Malayalam translation of it. I don't know the other languages. Kareyunna kakakunyinum adinde aaharam adinde samayathu kodukkunu. And I don't know how you translate the other languages. It's a very beautiful expression. When the young ravens cry, who provide for them? It is God himself. God himself. When we come to the New Testament, that we read Jesus preaching about the same thing. In chapter 12 of Luke, in Matthew chapter 6, all these places, the do not worry context, Jesus says that. Look at the birds. They don't have the barns, they don't have storehouses, but God provide for all of them. And if God provide for all these birds, and he is asking a question there, are you valuable more than these things? When we become panic, when we become worry, when we become concerned, sometimes we forget who our God is. That is the problem many times that we face in life also. That is where we are challenged. Because as if we think that, you know, as the disciples once asked, you know, don't you care that we are going to perish? That's where we see, no. All our needs will be met. Psalms 84, verse 11. The psalmist says again, for the Lord God is a sun and shield. The Lord bestows favor and honor. No good things does he withhold from those whose walk is blameless. Now, those whose walk is blameless. The young lion may lack, but those who walk uprightly, God will not withhold any good things. And now you have a need. Now you are hungry, Jesus says, but your hunger will be satisfied. Your hunger will be satisfied. I think that Paul says the same thing in Philippians chapter 4, verse 19. We all know that verse, right? And my God, can you say that? My God shall supply all our, not some of our needs. My God shall supply all our needs according to Jesus of his glory in Christ Jesus. When God does, he does according to his glory, according to his ability. We give according to our ability, according to our conditions. But when God does, he does according to his condition, according to his ability, according to his glory in Christ Jesus. So when you are hungry now, that means the basic needs of life. We may not have it today, but be assured that God will let us go. We are not asking for luxury here. We are asking for the basic things, and God has promised that. And if any one of you need that in such a condition you are in, and the scripture tells us that God is able to provide for that. Number three, there we see next thing that Jesus says, those who are poor kingdom of God is yours. Those who are hungry, you will be satisfied. Those who blessed are you who weep now, for you will laugh later. You will be comforted later. Blessed are those who weep. Now, that doesn't mean that, don't misunderstand that when we say that, oh, Jesus was always like an angry person. You know, unfortunately, those who come from the eastern part of the world, we think that, you know, being spiritual means you have a long face. Always be serious. Don't move around, you know, like that, you know, then only you become spiritual. No, I never ever believe that at all. Because, you know, that is part of Jesus. How do we know that? Children came to Jesus. Do you, anywhere you see that any children go to a serious person? But if the children don't come to you, you maybe have to check your heart. Right? So it is, they're running towards them, just carrying them, right? No, Jesus said that. What was the purpose he came? You know, after done and said everything, in John chapter 15, verse 11, Jesus says that, I taught all these things that your joy may be complete. Your joy may be complete. So spiritual life is not dull at all. You know, it is not thing that always we are, you know, talk about this big stuff and, you know, always we talk about all these dead white people's theology and live like that. That's not what it is. That's what Jesus says. Joy. And Paul was even the prison. He said, rejoice in the Lord. I always say, rejoice. And the joy is part of it. So what the weeping that Jesus talked about over here? The weeping caused by the kind of oppression. You know, remember that some other time, tears is very vital. You know, one day I was going to ask Vidush to talk about tears one day actually, because I was reading about it. I don't have much of the understanding to go deeper, but it's very, very important. For to function your eyes to your vision, all those things, tears are also important. There is something called dry eye syndrome. People have to put artificial tears into their eyes also. So tears are part of our life. That is part of our makeup. That is good for our soul, for our spiritual life sometime. What happened those who weep? Jesus says that they will be laughier or they will be comforted. And the psalmist says that the weeping may endure for a night, but joy comes in the morning. The beauty of the scripture that we read is, you know what? When you are crying the tears, and this is again the expressions in the poetic language David was using, Lord, you store my tears in your bottle, is that not in your book? You know, every time there is a sigh that comes from our heart, remember that God sees that. Not even a single drop of dry of tears, that will not be wasted at all. When you cry, there are different reasons to cry. There is a tears of sorrow as we are mourning for our dear ones. You know, tears of failure maybe, like Peter cried. Tears of disappointment and discouragement. We may go through all these things. But I want to assure you this morning, according to the scripture, remember that God sees all those things. You will be comforted. You will be comforted. There is a beautiful expression we read in the Old Testament in Genesis chapter 16. Talk about Hagar. You all remember that story, right? Hagar was running away from Abraham, her master. And you know, she was used actually by her master and his wife. And when there was something is going on, they don't want her anymore at all. She was thrown away from house. She had nowhere else to go. She was in the wilderness, in the desert. And there she cried. And there we read in Genesis chapter 16, the God came down. God came down for her and talked to her. And she make a statement over there. God who sees, I have seen the God who sees me. And this is called El Roi. This morning, your groanings are not unnoticed. God sees those groanings and he understands the pain behind that. There is a beautiful scripture that we read in Exodus chapter 2 also. Now, when God is sending Moses back to rescue his people, that is what he said in Exodus chapter 22, verse the last part of that chapter. It says that, I have heard their cries. I have seen their tears. I have concerned over them. I come down. This morning, my dear brothers and sisters, those who mourn for the death of our dear ones, one day we will see them. We will be comforted. They are not dead and gone. They are promoted to glory. That is our hope. That is what we sing songs in our funerals. Because this is the time that we say goodbye and celebrate our people's life. And we are going to see them one day. That is a blessed hope that we have. But if you are groaning for something else, and if you are groaning for the sins of your life, that's a good thing. That is a tears of repentance. That's a good thing. That is recorded in the scripture. But if you are thinking that nobody understands you, you are used and thrown away by others now, and you are misunderstood by people, and if that is your condition, the scripture tells us that the El Roi, the one who sees your groaning, is here this morning. And he says that he will comfort you. And who else can comfort you like God can comfort? No one else can. People may say that, I understand. It's okay. You know, we have a problem with our own emotions. So we jump into conclusions in other people's problem. We try to tell them it's okay. Never ever tell anyone else it's okay. It is not okay at all. You don't understand that at all. You simply stand there, that's okay. But don't say that it is okay. No, pain is pain. It is challenging. Sickness is difficult. Sorrows that go through people's life, only they know. But someone else can understand, that is God. And you know, when you look at the cross, that is what you see. Every human emotions, you are able to identify on the cross. Every human emotions, you are able to identify on the cross. If you are rejected, misunderstood, ill-treated, you know, if you are went through all these things, he understands that. Jesus tells his disciples, if you are mourning now, you will be comforted later. You will be comforted later. And not only that, those who do ministry, you know, remember that. This is difficult job. But those who sow with tears reap with joy. That is very important. You know, those who sow with tears reap with joy. That is a principle. There is a sowing and reaping principle in the scripture that we see as we go further. We learn that some other time. But Jesus tells these people, to the disciples, to you and me, in our circumstances, what will be our attitude? Jesus says that you will be comforted. You will be comforted. And this is not only a present day reality. There is an eschatological aspect of it. In Revelation chapter 21, verse 4 that we read, he will wipe every tear from their eyes. He will wipe every tear from their eyes. There will be no more death or mourning or crying or pain, for the old order of things has passed away. Remember that this is what we are looking forward. You know, we are going to have a recycled earth. People talk about this environmental thing and all, EPA. But remember that God, heaven is not only we are going there. The new Jerusalem is going to come down here. We are going to live here, recycled earth. No more tears, no more sorrows, no more mourning at all. So if you are crying now, there is a day is going to come to laugh and rejoice. And the third thing, Jesus said, blessed who you are when men hate you, when they exclude you and insult you and reject your name as evil because of the Son of Man. You know, we don't have the time go. You just see that what Jesus says here. Blessed are those who are persecuted. For what? For the sake of the Son of Man. Blessed who are persecuted for the sake of the Son of Man. When you are hated, when you are excluded, when you are insulted, when you are rejected, you know, what do? You rejoice. Remember that this century, more people died for the sake of Christ and for the gospel than the entire church history. You know, you see that now in news in the different parts of the world. People are not only just living a comfortable life. They didn't get many things that we have because we serve God. But they lost everything because they serve God. They are serving God currently still. They are faithfully serving God. And there's a day is going to come. It's already here. You know, Christian bashing is a national sport in this country and the Western Hemisphere now. That is what exactly happened many parts of the world also. When somebody insulted us, we are already afraid of it, right? Then you can see that people go through this kind of atrocities into their life simply because they believed in Jesus Christ. The same crime you and I did. You know, they were persecuted for that. Jesus tells them, you know, don't be afraid. What do then? You rejoice. Why you rejoice then? This is what the disciples heard. That's what exactly they have done. Jesus went through that, right? And the apostles also, each one of them, last week we said that. Each one of them, what happened to them? Other than John, you know, 10 of them were killed. One hanged himself because of his failure. Other 10 of them were killed one way or the other. The brutal death. cruel death. Why? Because they heard the teachings of Jesus. They obeyed and abide by it. We read in Acts chapter 5 verse 41. When they are scorned by the Sanhedrin, by the Jewish leaders, what was their response? They did a national campaign, getting all the signs and sent to their congressmen and said that you should not do it, right? That's what they did. They prayed first of all in chapter 4. Chapter 5, what they did say is that the apostle left the Sanhedrin rejoicing. What is the reason? Because they had been counted worthy of suffering disgrace for the name. Later that we talk about the woe, it says that when the people say good things about you, woe unto you. You know, this is the way they treated the false prophet. But when the people say all kinds of things because of me to you, rejoice. Why? Because you are in good company. This is what they have done to the master. This is what they have done to the prophets. This is what they have done to the apostles. That is one thing. This is the reason. Not only that, it says that you will have a reward in heaven. You will have a reward in heaven. When we baptize, people will say that be faithful unto death, you shall receive the crown of life. You know, salvation is by faith. Reward is based upon our works. So one day, you and I will get our crowns when we stand before the master. And look at these people, those who died glorious death for the gospel, for the sake of Christ. And Jesus says that they will be rejoiced because you are going to receive that reward. And many of us may not be ostracized because of your faith. Some of our dear sisters and brothers are here. They went through enormous challenges in their lives because they follow Christ. But remember that God will reward. One day we stand before Him, we can hear that good and faithful servant. That is what we are looking forward. Not the reputation of the people here, but we are going to receive the approval of the master over there. That is our desire. That is our dream also. Let us jump into the negative part of that what Jesus says over here. Four woes that we see. Four woes that contrast with the four blessedness or the beatitudes. Both condensed in the structure and the passage that we see, you know, that is just opposite to that. But woe to who you are rich again. Remember that again, the same group of people. To the disciples, you say that. The disciples, those who are willing to be poor for the sake of the gospel, those who are willing to, you know, be mocked for the sake of the gospel on behalf for the Son of Man or for Christ, and the things they go through in their life now. That is one group. If you reject, what happened then? You can be rich and famous and all the things over here. You can be, but there is a price you have to pay. So the theme is very simple. As we always say, tell to ourselves and our children, pay now and play later, or play now or pay later. That's as simple as it is. That is what Jesus tried to say that. There is, if you want to make, remember that the temptation the devil tried to bring before Jesus and said, bow down and worship. I will give you everything. Again, to live a life in such a way, you don't have to obey God at all. But there is a judgment that is going to come. There is a punishment, it is going to come, it is for sure. That is what also that we see over here. So Jesus says here, but woe to who you are rich. Again, remember that richness is not talking about economic richness. No, it can be. The problem that Luke mentioned throughout the scripture is, or his writing is this. People, those who are rich, have a problem. Because why? You know, richness is not the problem. Their attitude towards richness. And they think that everything because of this. And they trust only their money or their wealth or their effort. That can be a problem. We talk about the people again. You know, remember in chapter 12, I think, 12 or 14. You talk about the rich fool again. A man who had a huge success. And what he said, eat and drink and go to Las Vegas. That is all life is, right? That is what it says. At the end of the day, what is, man? Have some party week after week, right? This is all, life is so short anyway. Why don't we enjoy it? That was their ideology. The pleasure was controlling and guiding them in all matter. That may be a problem. We read about the rich man, the Lazarus. There it says that, you know, Abraham tells the rich man, what? You were comforted. You live a lavish life. You had everything when you are on the earth. But what happened to this poor man? He didn't have anything else, right? So now that change over here. So what Jesus says over here, the richness again is not the money thing, but the attitude towards that. You know, if you trust only the wealth that we have, because unfortunately we all think that the wealth can give us some security. No, we have seen that multi-millionaires, billionaires become bankrupt one day and become beggars. The scripture tells us that wealth has wings, it can fly away. But these people trust only in the wealth. The other one we talk about, Luke 6:25, woe to those who are full now. The contrast of hungry and here it is full. What happened to this fullness again? These people, those who are only eating and they are living a lavish life, and they, as if they live that this is the only world that they have. The third group of people, woe to those who are laughing. That means again, is that mean that laughing is wrong or sin? No, that's what it says. But the question is that, what are you laughing about? What are you laughing at? You know, many of the things, the coerced joke that you hear, you should be shocked at, not be laughed. But unfortunately, that is what we enjoy in the name of entertainment. That is a problem. Nobody wants to call it a sin at all. You can use all kinds of language nowadays actually, and you come the bleep in between as if something wrong. No, people not realizing that what they are trying to say. They are just entertaining, enjoying all these things. When we come to Romans chapter 1, Paul talk about all these things again then. What happened to these people? People reject God. And they not only doing it, they are approving and enjoying that other people doing these things also. That is what happened to these people. Then finally Jesus says the woe to the people. When the world says the woe to you, when all men speak well of you. Is a contradiction there? When people, it is a good thing that people say good about us, right? What does that mean then there? You know, for that is how the fathers treated the false prophets. What happened? Jesus says that a person who is willing to stand for God's principle, of course there is a price to pay for that, right? That is what happened now also in the world. That is what exactly that happened with the world actually. When you are, Peter says that later, when you go through the fiery furnaces, don't be surprised. Because this is what we are signed up for. This is part of the packet. There was the fine print. You may not have read it actually. That is what it is. Don't be surprised. Don't think that the world is going to approve your life or your principles or your lifestyle. No. Because we are not belong to this world. Read along with these lines in John chapter 15. In the world hate you. Why? Because you belong to Jesus. And that is an identity, that is a mark that you belong to Christ also, right? When the world says good things about you, when the enemies say good things about you, be careful also. Oh, he's a very nice man. He'll never say that Jesus is only God. He never said that anything is wrong. He will never say that nothing is sin. What happened? He's a wonderful man. Look at that. What is the challenge here? The application is very simple. Are we looking for the approval of the world or we want to be faithful to God? It's very simple. Are we looking for the approval in our attitude, in our approaches, in our appearances? You know, we don't want to be stand out. We want to be just mingle along with the world. And we get the approval of the world. You know what happened? When you try to do that, you will lose both actually. The world will never trust you because you claim that you are a Christian and you don't abide by that. They know that, oh, he is already a double standard person. The world will not accept us. God will not accept us either. We will lost both. So it is better to stay one or the other. I think that is what we read in the book of Revelation says that not be lukewarm. Stand for our convictions that God has revealed. Because this is the reality we have lived here today. And there is a reward that goes to come in the future also. So this is the simple principle. Are we looking for the approval of the world or are we looking for the to be faithful with God? If you are trying to be receive the approval of the world, you can earn that here. You can be rich here maybe. Even the world can say it is successful. But that question that Jesus asked to that person was this, what happened tonight when you are called, your life is gone from here? Jesus called him as a fool. And you can see that a man who made enormous money, successful in all his business endeavors, everybody admire him. Because he is, you know, hiring people, he has all these things. But God called him as a rich, successful fool. Because his heart was in the wrong place. So this is very plain and simple. as Jesus trying to tell these disciples over here. Because the rest of the portion is difficult than this actually. Because love your enemies, pray for them, you know, don't judge other people, and do all these principles comes actually. In order to do that, we have to abide by these principles. The circumstances that we face, our attitude towards that. Let me conclude over here. If the false prophets may win the approval of the world, but our job as the prophets of God's kingdom in this world to live as faithful to the kingdom of God, to the teachings of the master. He is the one who called us. And again, the mandate is that if you want to follow, that is a choice that we make over here. How do we apply this principle into our life? How do we apply that into our life? Remember this, I will close here. You know, someone said like this, life is built on character. Character is based on value, decisions. Decisions come from our values. Life is built on character. Character is based on our decisions. Our decisions come from our values. So how do you build our character? With good decisions. How do you make good decisions? Based upon the values. Where do you get the values, by the way? The values can come from the environment, from our experience. But for a child of God, the values come from the scripture. That is what Jesus said. Remember that we talk about that, I believe, when we talk about the temptations. Jesus said, it is written. It is written. It is written. There is a principle to live by. The scripture never changed according to the culture. This supersedes all the cultures. There are so many cultures that come and go. But scripture standing above all those things. This is the principle. Jesus says that this is the way the citizens of God's kingdom should live. We read about examples. We don't have the time that we read. When people make these kind of decisions, you know, the world laughed at them. The world laughed at them. We read about the choice that Moses made in Hebrew chapter 11. Remember that thing? He said no to the comfort of Egypt. And he knew the positions as the son of Pharaoh's daughter. He rejected all those things. For what? To identify and take the reproach of the slaves. We see that what happened to Moses, what happened to Pharaoh. Pharaoh was drowned in the water. And Moses is revered even today, and we talk about him. God used him. That is what exactly happened. This morning, you know, this is the principle that Jesus asked us to live. Let us make a commitment that we will live by the scripture that is written. And the word that Jesus proclaimed, blessed are those who are poor. If you have any, God will, of course. If you are hungry, God will satisfy. If you are weeping, he will comfort. When you are rejected, insulted, hated, persecuted, ostracized by others because of the gospel, the stand that you take, stand on the principle because you are in good company and also the reward is great. Woe those who are trust in their richness, their efforts in this world. Those who are just indulge in the things of this world, and one day they are going to cry. That is for sure. Judgment, salvation is a personal thing. It is free. Judgment is also a personal thing. One day we all have to stand before the judgment seat of God. Let us fear God, worship him, and serve him faithfully. Let us pray together. 1 minute, we will, every time we do this, this is not just an emotional thing, but to rewind our mind. We have said so many things. This is to refresh our mind, to reflect upon what we have said, what we have learned. It has been said, revelation without application is futile. Revelation without application is futile. It is nothing. We can learn great things, great principles. But if you don't apply that, it has no value at all. You know, the one we teach, the one we learn, and we all are together in this journey. We are not saying that we are perfect people. We are not here to beat up anyone else, to condemn or to bring judgment or to guilt upon people. But this is the revelation of God's word. This is, we want to become like Christ. That is our desire. That is what we want to do. Would you please pray? Those who have need, we pray with you and pray for you. Those who are mourning, God will comfort you. Those who are groaning in their heart, God's Holy Spirit is here to comfort us. The tears that you shed before the Lord will not go wasted. God will reward you. He will comfort you. And if we spend time before the Lord, God will do that. And if you have a need this morning, and He has promised, look at the birds. It has no barns, no storehouse, and it will not sow and reap. But God provide everything that they need at their time. The same God will provide for you, because you are, Jesus tells that, you are worth more than these birds, because you are God's creation. Not only that, you are redeemed by His blood. He gave His blood to redeem you. If that's the case, how valuable you and I are. So, don't be puzzled. The things may not go the way that you want to, but God will prepare us and to receive God. God is making us to receive what God is preparing for us. Let us pray. We'll pray for you. If you have need, please come. I believe that the Holy Spirit is ministering to you this morning. You come. But at the same time, leave this room. Go out. Stand strong for the gospel, for Christ, for His principles. And be bold and declare that I am a child of God. You may be hated. You may be rejected. You may be ostracized. You may be insulted by all these things. That's all right, because that's what they have done to Christ. That's what the apostles, you are in good company. God will reward you also. Father, we thank you for this morning. Lord, we thank you for your word. Lord, we pray that you give us the strength to obey your word. Lord, we are not able to do it our own strength. But Holy Spirit, thank you that you abide in us. You live in us. You give us the ability and the strength, Lord, to live a holy life, victorious life for God. It is not that we are trying, oh God. Rather, we trust in you, Jesus. Holy Spirit, we surrender our life to you this morning. Forgive us, oh Lord, we pray. Help us to focus on you. May the eternity, every decision that we make, Lord, will be based upon eternity, oh God. We pray that help us to have that eternal perspective about the wealth and the things of this world, oh God. Lord, we have an eternal perspective about the problems that we face in our life, oh Father. We pray for everyone those who are here.